Hello, in this clip we will talk about nullable types and nullability and why it has gotten so much attention recently despite it being an issue since forever. So let's commence. If you watched my clip about memory and the stack versus heap, you already know that some data types are defined by always having a value, therefore being called value types, while the others are called reference types because they rely on indirection, on some stack cell pointing to some heap cell. And in that clip I was mentioning that if the stack cell points to nothing on the heap, we call that a null value, or that the variable is null. What I didn't mention in that clip is that value types can also store null values, because sometimes we want, for example, to ask a client their information, and while the email is mandatory, the age is optional. And yes, we could store 0 or minus 1 as no value, but conceptually those are wrong. They are not the same thing as no age at all. Therefore, we have a way to store value types as nullable types by putting a question mark after the data type like this. And just for the sake of this lesson's completion, I'll mention that this is an alias for nullable of t like this, and that it's implemented using a generic struct, but we haven't learned about generics nor structs, therefore that's all I will say for now. Just know that I'm planning at some point to make an advanced version of this video, because nullable types are not implemented the way most programmers think. So if when I'll make that video, if I'll remember, I'll link it in the description below. Anyway, as I already mentioned, and as you already know, reference types can store null values. And in fact, that's their default value. And I know we haven't learned about classes. I know I keep saying we will soon, but I promise in 2-3 lessons we will. So at this point, the only reference types that we know of are object and string. So let's use a string as an example. The first thing to notice is that in the case of the reference type, we don't have to put the question mark after the data type like we did in the case of the value type. Or do we? Because if I hover null, it's saying converting null literal or a possible null value to non-nullable type. Wait, what? What does it mean with non-nullable type? Isn't string a reference? Isn't it nullable? Well, yeah, but there is a nuance to it. We will discuss it later in this video. The second difference lies in the way nullable value types can be assigned. So for example, if you try something like this, you will get an error. Why? Because nullable value types, remember, they can have a value, but they can also be null. So if you try to assign a nullable int to a regular int, what if the nullable int is null? You can't assign null to a regular int. We need a way to determine basically if the nullable value type has a value or is null. And that can be done with the help of a property called HasValue. But HasValue is still not enough, because the compiler needs assurances that what we are assigning to a non-nullable type is not null. And it can't infer that only from HasValue. We still have to do it manually like this. And hopefully you still remember what a ternary operator is. We have a Boolean condition, and based on that, if it's true, we take this operand. If it's false, we take the other operand. So in this case, we assign based on age, the nullable type, HasValue. If it's true, it will take the value with the value property. So we have also a dedicated property to get the value of a nullable value type. Otherwise, if HasValue is false, so the nullable type is null, we assign 0. So this is a sort of a fallback, which in either case, it will assign a regular int to the regular int. Either we assign the value of a nullable type if that nullable type has a value, or we assign 0. So in short, for nullable value types, since they have this duality of both value type and reference type behavior, when we assign them to reference types, we simply assign them. So a nullable int can be directly assigned to a nullable int. And when we assign them to regular value types like a normal int, we use HasValue and value. There is a third way to call a method called GetValueOrDefault like this. And the difference between accessing the property value and calling GetValueOrDefault is if age is null, so our nullable variable is null, if we try to access value, we will get an exception. If we call getValueOrDefault, we will get the default for that data type. So 0 for int, false for boolean, and so on. Now, let's discuss why nullability is such a focused upon topic in recent years. So if you do this, you will get an exception. That's because name is null. And when you try to access something on something that is null, so you do dot to lower value, etc., on something that is null, which means nothing, there is no to lower, there is no value. So you get an exception, more precisely a null reference exception, which is one of the most, if not the most common exception you'll get in your career. And because it's such a prevalent source of errors, the C# language designers decided in C# 8 to improve the situation by adding something that we call nullable reference types. Yes, you've heard me correctly, nullable reference types. Of course, reference types are already nullable, they accept null values, but prior to C# 8, there was no way to differentiate between accidental nullability and intentional nullability. So there was no way to differentiate between I declare a string name and I assign null to it because I have no name yet. Maybe I'll get it later from the console or from the database. And nullability because, I don't know, of a bug or something. Nullable reference types solve this ambiguity by making null assignments explicit for reference types too. And for consistency, the same question mark is used for them too, like this. And you can see that we are assigning null to both unknown name and name. But of the two, only name is underlined with a green squiggly line. That's because when you say string name, you basically say, I know it's a reference type. I know it can store null, but it shouldn't. On the other hand, when you say nullable reference, so string question mark, it's, I know it's a reference, it can store null. And yes, it should store null, because I don't have a name right now. I will take it later from the console. On the other hand, when we said string name, so not nullable, I know it can store null, but it shouldn't, we lied, because we immediately assigned null to it. And the compiler is yelling at us, telling, okay, you said that it shouldn't store null, but you are assigning null. What's happening here? That's the reason why we get the green warning. Maybe you remember, maybe you don't, but we used to get the same green warning when we were using console.readline, like this. That's because readline returns a nullable string, which we are trying to assign to a string that shouldn't accept null according to our declaration. So all in all, nullable reference types don't do anything practically. They are just an extra layer of protection against null reference exception, a way for us programmers to see potential places where null could be assigned to something that shouldn't. We know it should not contain null. There are four operators tied to nullability in C#, one of them being null propagation operator, which again is a question mark. How many question marks are there in C#? We have name, which we know it can be null, but we also need to convert all its characters to lowercase, which means we need a way to only call to lower when name is not null, because we know that when we do dot anything on something that is null, it will blow in our faces with an exception. So we need to do something like this. And we use a ternary operator to first check if name is not null, and only then call to lower. Otherwise, just use name, which means the original string will be concatenated with nothing, with null. So all this ternary operation is shortened to this. This is what null propagation operator does. It only executes the right-hand operand if the left-hand operand is not null. And the reason why it's called null propagation operator is if name is null, the result of the operation is null. So the null is returned, is propagated, which means I can do this, where I call to lower only if name is not null, but if name is null, the result will be null, which means I will not call contains, because again, I use the null propagation operator to only call contains if the result of the previous call is not null. So basically, I can chain as many methods as I want without the fear that one of them will be called on something that is null and result in an exception. But this has a consequence. The fact that if you remember from the past lesson, contains returns a Boolean result, either true or false, if it contains or not the string. So contains returns a bool. But in this case, it's not quite a bool, is it? Because yes, it's true false if it contains or not John, but it's also null if name is null. If the result is propagated from method call to method call, we have actually a nullable bool, which needs to be explicitly checked against truthness. It cannot be implicitly checked like we used to for regular ifs. Still related to question marks, we have null coalescing and null coalescing assignment operators. The first one will assign the value of name to another name, but only if name is not null. If it's null, then it's assigning the string John. The second one assigns the string John to another name, but only if another name is initially null. Finally, we have the null forgiving operator, or the null suppression operator, or the unary postfix operator, or the bang operator, or whatever you want to call it, but we declare a string and we don't declare it as a nullable reference, so we don't put a question mark. But we also assign null to it. Yet the compiler doesn't yell at us with a warning because we put this exclamation mark, which basically tells the compiler, shush, I know that it shouldn't accept null, I know I'm giving it null, but this is just a temporary solution. Immediately after, I will either assign a value to it, or I will call a method that will return a value or whatever. I know that soon this will have a value and I don't want to declare it nullable reference, because afterwards, every single time I will try to do something with it, I will get a warning. I will need to make checks to check if it's not null, to etc. And I know it will not be. So now you know about nullability. Your C# ninja skills just got upgraded. And for that, you should thank me by liking this video, and maybe subscribe for even more upgrades. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next tech frame.